Hello my retro gaming friends and welcome back to another repair video. And gosh, this is sure has been one that's been in the making for quite a long time. I bought this Atari Lynx 2 on eBay in late November 2019 for just under $60. $60 isn't too bad. I've seen working tested ones sell for $80, but the prices vary all over the place. I've seen untested as-is models that people have been trying to flog for upwards of $400, so I don't really have a baseline of how much these are worth in Australia, but $60 seemed like a pretty decent sell. So, what's the diagnosis? Well, it doesn't turn on, which is very common for Atari Lynxes, which is one of the reasons I bought this particular one. But as you can see, putting in the millions of batteries that it takes results in nada. I don't have it on camera here because I didn't actually have one when I was filming, but I did later try a power supply and got the same result. So doing a bit of research, there are a few things that can make an Atari Lynx not turn on, but we'll get into that throughout the course of this video. To start with, I can actually hear something rattling around on the inside. So let's get on with pulling this thing apart. So somewhat sneakily, there are four Phillips head screws hiding under these rubber bumper things. So you have to peel these off to get to the screws, and I haven't actually put them back on since taking them off, but I'll get into why later in the video. Otherwise, unscrewing the four screws is as easy as unscrewing four screws is. And removing the back case reveals that the console's actually good. Oh well, I guess that's the end of the video, guys. Nah, just kidding. That's an absolute lie. The damn thing doesn't turn on. It was also at this point where I found a bit of plastic that was rattling around. Not the component I had hoped for, but that solves that mystery. There is one more additional screw holding in the battery compartment, and make sure you separate the screws from the others for when you're putting it back together. The reason this screw is shorter is because there are ribbon cables right behind it, and I've heard stories of people accidentally putting in the longer screws and piercing right through those ribbon cables, so that is just something to note. Otherwise, there are those said ribbon cables, and they are held in by a couple of latches. So use a fingernail or a flat-headed screwdriver or a spudger or whatever you can find to unclip those. And then there are a few additional plugs, which you can just pull out. And straight away, we can see that there is an inductor holding on for dear life. So it's always nice when there is physical damage like that, because that is always a very good starting point. But I figured, since I was already on my way, I may as well disassemble the other half of the console to see if there's anything going on there as well. And disassembly on this part is really quite simple. It's just loads and loads of screws, and once all those are removed, you can pull out the screen, which is handily built into one module. Underneath that, there is this membrane thing, or let's just call that a module as well, that has all the buttons and the LED light and also the speaker. Kind of handy that this is all built into one thing, but if something were to go wrong here, it would be a very difficult repair. Otherwise, all the physical buttons themselves are just held in with gravity, so be careful if you turn this thing upside down. So I didn't have any inductors on hand, so I thought before I popped down to the local friendly electronic shop, I'd just see if I could solder it back on. Why not? There's really nothing to lose. I actually forgot to film myself soldering that, but you know, not really missing out on much. And I don't really have any footage after this, but I assume I put it all together and it still didn't work. And a big reason I can't remember if I filmed it or not is because the next footage isn't until April 2020. I also can't really remember why I waited so long to work on it again after I just pulled it all apart. But I think I had a few different repair projects on the go at the time and some other stuff happening, so it just got pushed back. But April is where I jumped back in. And April 2020, depending on what time you're watching this, there was some stuff going down. And this would impact the repair even later on. But we'll get to that when we need to. So kind of hard to see here, it's a bit of an awkward location to film, but it looks like something seriously bad has gone on with the power circuit. So you can see that capacitor there, it's all blown out at the bottom, so we will be removing that and replacing it. And the inductor, I popped down to the shop and I found one that was way too big, but it should still work. It looks like the capacitor has just been salvaged from something else out of my parts bin. Generally, this is probably not the best idea for capacitors. If you're putting in new ones, you probably want to put in brand new ones because they are usually a huge fail point. But regardless, this did do the job, speaking from the future. Although this didn't fix it, you'll have to keep watching to find out what did. Regardless, that capacitor did need to be replaced. So I went through my general process, I fluxed it up, then I used my handy $30 Chinese desoldering pump to get rid of the solder. And this thing really works wonders. I'll probably get a proper branded one day, but while this thing's still working, I'm really happy to keep using it. And being a through-hole component, it really is that easy to remove it. Just pull the old one out and put the new one in. And as you can see, giving a bit of a blurry close-up here, this thing is definitely messed up. So even if it isn't actually the problem, which I figured it might not have actually have been, even though it does look really bad, it still needed to be replaced. If it wasn't a problem today, it was definitely going to be a problem tomorrow. And removing the inductor was done more or less the same way, although this was a little bit easier since it was only technically connected by one leg. And the remaining leg was then simply removed using pliers and a soldering iron. And from there, it's generally good practice to get rid of any old solder if a capacitor has leaked nearby, and then give the whole board a good clean of isopropyl alcohol. This gets rid of any flux, but also any other residue that's on there that could cause issues later on. After that, I applied some fresh solder, and then I just put the new components in. Pretty easy. I did have to leverage the board up to put the inductor in since it is kind of big. And in retrospect, I probably wouldn't use batteries to do this since, you know, soldering irons are quite hot and they have quite a directional tip at the end of it. And, you know, batteries do not like that. But I survived, but I wouldn't recommend that you do it. And I probably wouldn't do it myself again. Okay, I don't have any footage after that, but I assume I did test it and it didn't work. So I'm going to try something now, which I do not recommend. I found this Googling the issue, but it's a very bad idea, and I'll tell you why. But basically what I'm doing here is running a bodge wire between, I think it was a capacitor leg and the minus side of the battery outputs. What this basically does is bypass the power circuit completely, which is usually a failure point. Sounds good in theory, but I'll tell you why that you should not do it. And someone on Reddit sent me straight, and I'm really glad they did. So basically, the Lynx runs on 5 volts, but it takes a 9 volt input. So the power circuit converts the 9 volts into 5 volts, and all the ICs and everything on the board run on 5 volts. Putting this bodge wire in means that you're actually running 9 volts throughout the entire system, which is really bad for it. It's usually the reason why there are so many Lynxes out there with broken power circuits, because, you know, people put in the wrong power supply or whatever. So this is a really bad way to test it, and I will show you a better way to test it later on in this video. But it did actually give me hope, because with that bodge wire installed, it turned on. Didn't get anything though, it was literally just the backlight powering on. But after I messed around with it a little bit, I think I might have cleaned a cartridge, I did get a very garbled insert game message. So this showed to me that something was going on the insides. The whole thing wasn't completely fried yet. But if I kept that bodge wire in, no doubt it would have. And since it was so garbled, it means the ICs weren't handling the 9 volts very well. I still wasn't getting anything from the buttons or even the red LED, which, if you remember, is all a part of this one membrane module. So I had a little bit of a closer look at the ribbon cable and saw that it was quite worn away on the edges. So yeah, I don't know if there is a better way to do this. I'm not sure if there is a way to replate those connectors on the edge, but I simply just snipped off the bad bit. And hey, what do you know? I still got the garbled insert game message, but I now had the red LED, so that showed that that bit was also broken separately. So there is a very safe way to test this using just 5 volts so you don't accidentally fry your links. This shot here is a little bit unrelated, but I did solder in a 9 volt battery pack just so testing would be a little bit easier since the battery compartment is a bit finicky. Otherwise, we need some sort of 5 volt source. So as you probably know, early types of USB are 5 volts. You could probably use an old phone adapter if you wanted to. I instead decided to cannibalize an old mini USB cable, since I have seemingly millions of them in a box. The mini USB end can be snipped off and put in a bin, and then I splice the wires. There are 5 or 6 wires in a USB cable, but we only need 2. The negative and positive power rails. Usually these are the black and red wires, but you probably just want to test this with a multimeter just to confirm, because you don't want to mix up the polarity. So let's get rid of that potentially dangerous 9 volt bodge wire and figure out where we're going to connect this USB cable. Well, I didn't figure out myself, I just read this on the internet, but on the Atari Lynx 2 at least, not sure about the original version, you want to look for capacitor 41, which is labeled as C41 on the board. And really, this mod couldn't be any simpler. The negative wire solders to the negative leg, and same for the positive. So let's just plug this into a USB power supply. Luckily, there's a USB port built right into my lamp, and We have a winner. We have sound. It's a bit hard to see in the angle filmed here, but the contrast on the screen is quite good. So that garbled picture is gone. This proves that the ICs aren't fried, which is good because we can't really replace those. You will notice though that, unfortunately, there is a black shadow over the left portion of the screen. As far as I know, this is not something that can be repaired, which is certainly a shame, but I'll let you know at the end of the video what we're going to do about that. But now, we have all the proof we need to know that the power circuit is the issue. So, how does one go about repairing that? Well, you can go on a lovely website called Console5, and I should give you the obligatory, this is not a sponsored video, I did buy this with my own money, but that's fine because it's really cheap. You can buy packs from Console5 that have all the correct components in it to completely redo the power circuit. It quite literally only costs $2 to get one of every component, but it's actually only $8 to get multiple components, and since a few of them are SMD, which is something I am very unskilled at replacing, I figured I may as well buy them in bulk, and then I'll also have the parts on hand for any Atari Lynxes I should happen upon in the future. I had a very hard time sourcing any of these components locally, so I was happy to find this pack. However, I did order them at a very bad time. Yes. The elephant in the room. Obviously, COVID-19 impacted a little package getting from America all the way to Australia. So, how long does a little packet of components take to reach Australia during a global pandemic? Well, it didn't arrive until June. I didn't actually think they were ever going to arrive. I was keeping an eye on the tracking and it went through several different cities before finally getting itself onto a plane, over the ocean, and into my grubby hands. So, what do you get in the tune-up kit? First off, we have the MOSFET ICs, which are one of the usual culprits of a Lynx not turning on. These, apparently, easily get fried. Next up, we have a little packet of 3906 transistors, and there are two of these that will need to be replaced. We also have a Zener diode. This is the other major culprit of failure, besides from the MOSFET IC. The kit also comes with some 30 ohm resistors. These aren't always needed, and I can tell you right now that I didn't need to use this myself. But if you replace all the other components and it's still not working, apparently there are a few models out there that will need this resistor replaced as well. Lastly, we have a replacement power jack. Supposedly these have internal switches that can fail. I know for a fact that mine was working fine, but I figured since I had the part and I was refurbishing the system anyway, I may as well replace it. So here we can see the components that are to be replaced. There are the two transistors next to each other, as well as the Zener diode just above it. The MOSFET IC is just hiding in between that humongous inductor I replaced earlier and a couple of capacitors, and the power jack is obviously where the power jack is. No mystery there. So I have very little experience removing SMD components, but I figured this was a good learning project since those components needed to be replaced regardless. I started off with the Zener diode, and a good strategy usually is just to dump a bunch of solder on it and make it all molten, and then you can move the component. This didn't quite work with the Zener diode, but I actually gave up for the time being and moved over onto the transistors. The solder dumping strategy worked for those as they came off with relative ease. A lot easier than I thought, actually. Putting the new ones back on was a bit finicky since they're so small, but I got there in the end. Removing the MOSFET was also a little bit of a pain because there's actually quite a bit of solder holding that to a heat plane on the board. At least I think it's a heat plane. Regardless, I tried to go the other route and just desolder as much as I could, but this was proving to be quite difficult. So, since I was replacing it anyway, I decided just to cheat a little bit and I snipped off the legs. With the legs snipped off, it was actually quite a bit easier to just pry the whole MOSFET off the board. Ta-da! And then it was just really easy to remove the legs. I could just use some tweezers for that. Putting the new MOSFET on is a lot easier than taking the old one off. You just have to use lots of solder. But being the biggest component in the pack, besides from the power jack, I put it on with quite a bit of ease. And the last thing to put on is the power jack, which was really easy since it is a through-hole component. So I can use my trusty desoldering pump thing. And here we go, here's all the new components on, except for the Zener diode. And I think I did a pretty good job. It does look like there is a bit too much solder on the transistors, but I did end up rectifying that later on, although I think that amount of solder was probably okay. So I didn't show it on video, but I did put it back all together again at this point and tried it with 9 volts and still got nothing. It did work on 5 volts still, so I showed I didn't somehow break it even more, but it's obvious that I had to now replace that Zener diode. Unfortunately, I didn't catch this on camera either, but I ended up removing it just by desoldering as much as I could and then heating up around the edge and pulling it off with tweezers. Putting on the new Zener diode is easy peasy, and it's now time for the grand reveal. Will it work on 9 volts? And the answer to that, well, the video speaks for itself.
The screen's so much more powerful on 9 volts. Which I guess makes sense. I don't know how well that's showing. It is working though, it's running off batteries. Let's try for the power supply.
And yes, plugging in the power supply proved the same result. We have fixed this Atari Lynx. It took 6 months, nearly 7 months, but at the end of the day, it was fixed with $2 worth of components. If that's not a win, I don't know what is. So with that, we can remove the various wires that are no longer needed and put this thing back together. And of course, there's always one mystery screw left over. But that doesn't matter, let's play some Paperboy. But wait, there's still the loose end that is the screen. Now, I would love to keep this thing as original as possible, but buying replacement screens isn't really something you can do. And in reality, it's probably something you don't want to do since the quality of the screen isn't really that great, let's be honest. So, I went back to Console 5, and I should stress this video is not sponsored in any way, and I purchased the Micwell LCD upgrade kit for Atari Lynx 2 redesigned version 2. Yes, this will be my first LCD mod in any console. Generally, I like to keep things stock, but since the screen is pretty damaged anyway and I have an otherwise completely working unit, I figured this would be a good place to start. And plus, this kit allows me to install a VGA output, which I can use for game capture for reviews. It's a bit of a win-win no-brainer, really. So I have put that order in. Who knows how long the shipping will take this time. Hopefully it'll be a little bit quicker since we're not in April anymore, but that will be a future video. Either way, we've fixed the links as much as we can up to this point, so I want to thank you for watching. This has certainly been a journey, and I'll see you in the next video.